Now, that's better. It's good to see everyone here this morning. We welcome those who are watching online. I was going to get that number on my phone like Elliot does so he can impress everybody with those numbers that those are listening. And for some reason, I can't get it. That just shows I'm not high tech. I know. I was going to try to impress you with that, but it didn't work. Well, at least you're impressed that I have a cell phone. That's pretty good for an old codger like me. If you're visiting with us, I am not the regular minister. We have a very capable minister. Elliot, from time to time, needs a rest. And so I'll be speaking this morning, and not only that, that gives me an opportunity to wear my new suit. Actually, it's not new. It's about a year and a half old. He said, well, Bob, if you didn't need a suit a year and a half ago, why'd you buy it? It was on sale. Ladies, you aren't the only ones who look for sales. Not only was it on sale, but it fits. A lot of the clothes that I buy on sale don't fit that well, but I buy them anyway to save money. It's a good thing that I don't live in a culture where men had to pay a dowry to buy their wives from their wives' father. I'd be waiting for a sale, and there's no telling what kind of wife I would come up with. So I'm glad I don't live in that period of time. But Linda paid me a nice compliment this morning. She says, honey, you look nice. And I said, well, thank you. I thought if I couldn't impress the congregation with my knowledge, I'd dazzle them with my good looks. She looked at me and said, honey, I hate to tell you this. You better stay with the knowledge part. Well, I said, I may be 77 years old, but I didn't know how to finish that sentence, so I didn't say anything else. I'm wondering if the rest of you have a problem in opening packages in today's world. It seems like when you get something at the store, it takes forever to get it opened. Now, I understand there's a reason for that. Now, because of the high theft rate, the retail stores want it packaged that way so that the thieves can't just come in and quickly open, stick it in their pocket, and walk out of the store. And there's a health element. The bottles that we buy are often sealed so that there can't be tampering and someone put something in the bottle that shouldn't be. I understand all that, but that still doesn't keep it from being difficult for me to open those packages. Last week, Linda was making some stew and she needed some ground up parsley. So she got this new bottle of parsley out of the pantry and couldn't get the top open. You take off the lid and you got this little tab that sticks up. And she was pulling on it, trying to get it open, and she asked me if I could help. So I took it and I pulled. Finally, I could get a grip on it. I pulled it open. The top comes off, but you still can't get inside. So you have to get something sharp, poke a hole in it in order to get to where you want to be able to access what's in the bottle. Last Thursday and Friday, I was in Oklahoma City at a tax seminar, and I got up Friday morning, went downstairs to have breakfast, and I wanted a light breakfast, so I just got this little box of cereal. You know, they come in those little one-serving size boxes, and I opened it up, and like all cereal, you know, you pull it open, and you've got a handful of cereal and all of this plastic at the top. I couldn't get it open. The software was plastic, or the silverware was plastic. The knife couldn't cut it. The fork wouldn't break it. Finally, after many tries, I found just the right spot and was able to pull it apart. Yeah, try that. Tell me, how does that work for you? Usually it doesn't. And when you buy something like dental floss, some of the packages have plastic on the front of them. Now, they've got cardboard on the back. You can't get through the front. Supposedly, you can turn them on the back, and they've got those little dotted lines where, you know, they make you think it's perforated, but it's not. You know? And so you poke your thumbnail in there, and you keep poking until you break your thumbnail. You have to give up, get something sharp, poke a hole in it, and get it out. Sometimes, before I get to that, sometimes let's talk about these packages. They have plastic on both the front and the back. And they are put together in such a way there's no way you're going to separate the front from the back. You can tear them. You can drive over it with a Mack truck. It ain't coming apart. Really frustrating to get into those. Well, I thought surely somebody has invented a device to where you can get into packages, something that will cut them open and save all of this frustration. I got online, and sure enough, here was this super-duper package opener. It's called the Piranha. Even got a picture of one down at the bottom. This thing has got to be a package-eating booger. I want this. It's going to save a lot of frustration in my life. The plastic package opener, as seen on TV. Now, I know it's got to work, because it's been on TV. It's safe. That's good, because sometimes I actually cut myself trying to open some of those plastic packages. It's fast. I'm all for that. And it's easy. What a lifesaver. This is going to make my life so much easier. Had to get online to get it. Now, I'm old-fashioned. I don't like to buy things online. When I buy things, I want to give them money, and I want to get what I'm buying. But because I wanted this so badly, I got online, I gave them my credit card number, and I ordered it, expecting that it would show up in 2 or 3 days. I eagerly awaited its arrival. Finally, a week later, it comes in the mail. And I am so happy. You're probably wondering how it worked. I don't know. I can't open the package. Barriers are frustrating. And yet we find them in all walks of life. Now, put that thought aside a minute. And let's talk about our lesson. Are we there? Aha! Thank you. In the last several weeks, Elliot has been talking to us about walking step in step with the Spirit, the fruits of the Spirit. Have you had a chance to really think about what that looks like in your mind, to acquire all of these spiritual attributes that enable us to walk step by step in the Spirit? The first thing we talked about was love. And love is such a great thing. It covers so many parts of our life to make it better. God is love, and for us to have love gives us a bit of God's nature. We understand what love is like when we are married to someone and we have that special feeling toward them that binds us together through thick and thin. Paul in 1 Corinthians 13 describes some of the attributes of love, of how great it is and how wonderful love blesses our life. He also talked about joy. Everybody wants to be happy. Our Constitution supposedly gives us the right to pursue happiness, and that is the goal in life of many of our people in America. I just want to be happy. Joy enables us to have that feeling of happiness. The Spirit gives us that as one of its fruits. And then there's peace. It is so nice to be able to lay down at night and not worry, to be able to go to sleep. Even in a world that is ridden with turmoil and trouble, To have that peace of mind that passes all understanding is a great blessing, and the Spirit offers that to us. To be patient. Since we have peace, we don't have to have that anxiety, and we can just wait on the Lord, wait for things to happen. It may not come when we want it, but that's all right. We know that the Lord is in control, and I can just wait until He brings it, if He brings it at all. I know that's okay. And it's so good to have kindness. Whenever you see someone being treated kindly, it just sort of warms your heart. When someone sees another person's needs and fulfills that needs, it's a beautiful thing. Have you ever been racked? You know, those initials, R-A-K, random act of kindness. When someone just automatically or by chance does something good for you and they're so kind. Maybe they buy you a meal, you go up to pay at the register, and the clerk says, it's already paid for. Who paid for it? I don't know. That's a great thing to do, and it's a great thing to be on the receiving of that, because kindness makes our world so pleasant. And then the Spirit gives us goodness. When there's a need, we fulfill it. The Bible tells us that we are created to do good works. And when we're able to do that, it makes the world better, it makes God happy, and it brings about a result that makes life more meaningful. And then there's the fruit of being faithful. It's so nice to know that you can rely on other people. As God is faithful, like, can you rely on Him, so are others. And so you can join arms with others, walk the Christian walk together, knowing that if you stumble, you can rely on the person next to you. If you have a need, they're going to be there to faithfully fulfill that need. And then there's the gentleness. Some events in life just require gentleness. 2 or 3 years ago, an elderly lady came into my office, and she was so distraught. She had had a small accident, and it wasn't a big accident, but it just tore her up emotionally. She didn't know if she should be driving or not, but she wanted to, and she had this accident, and she came in, and she was a client of mine, and she came for her appointment, and she was so disturbed. The only thing that could comfort her was some kind of gentleness. And I felt fortunate that God had blessed me with the ability just to sit down and put my arm around her and say, it's going to be okay. Don't worry about it. We'll take care of this. And after a few moments, she finally settled down. Gentleness is an attribute of Christ, and we can see how gentle He was in dealing with people who had needs, because it is a blessed attribute of the Spirit. And then there's the self-control. Boy, oh boy. This is so hard to attain. To be able to say to yourself, no, I'm not going to do that even though I want to. And yes, I am going to do that because I need to. That self-control is hard to attain, and yet the Spirit brings that blessing to us. And then on top of all of these things that make life so pleasant and so rich, there is this concept in 1 John 1 and 7. If we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus, His Son, purifies us from all sins. When we walk with the Spirit step by step, we're walking with God step by step. And when we walk with Him, we have that forgiveness of sins. What an awesome picture. What a great way to live. And I think all of us want that. And then Eliot tells us how we can accomplish it. He says we've got to remember that God is there to help us through those hard times. We need to pray constantly. We need to trust in God. We need to submit to Him. And we need to step in faith, knowing that God will be with us all the way. Step out of our comfort zone, but continually walk with God and the Spirit. That is a great way to live. But I have this question. Are we there yet? Have we been able to attain that degree of spirituality? We've been told what it's like, and we want it, and Elliot has told us how we can get it, but are we there yet? I have to tell you that I'm not. Although I so badly want to feel that I'm walking step by step, and God is holding my hand, and I'm on that path locked into His way of life 100%, I'm just not there. And I got to feel that there may be some of you that aren't quite there either. It's like there is a 2-inch plastic barrier stuck in front of me, separating me from that road that I want to be on. Now, if you have attained that, no, you can't leave. Set back down. This lesson's not for you, but you need to hang around to help the rest of us get to where you are. And thinking about this the last several weeks, two things have come to mind. Sometimes we just wake up and we find ourselves on this path over here when I know I need to be over here. We don't know how we got there. We're just there, and we know we shouldn't be there. It's not something we intentionally did. It just happened. And we wonder, how did that happen? A few weeks ago, Lynn and I took a 2.5-week vacation, the longest vacation we've ever been in our lives, been on. We went to Kentucky, went to the Ark, we went to the museum in Cincinnati, drove up to Dayton, Ohio, and visited with the Forsythes, drove on up to Detroit, spent a week with some longtime Christian friends we've known for 60 years, and then started making our way back. We had our motor home and were still trying to get used to driving that monster. It was a little unnerving at times, but boy, we had made it through Cincinnati, we'd made it through Dayton, Ohio, we'd made it through Toledo, we'd even spent a week in Detroit, and coming back, we had all of our plans laid out. It was going to come through Indianapolis, and then through St. Louis, and on home. And I thought, we've got this made. Actually, I was feeling a little cocky about the ability to drive this thing. Indianapolis was going to pose a little bit of a problem because if you've ever looked at a map of Indianapolis, there are all kinds of roads in and around, exchanges by the dozens. But our GPS showed us how we can come here at the northeast corner and we can make our way around the outside edge, get back on track, and go directly to our night's destination. Piece of cake. Somehow or another, after we got into the outskirts of Indianapolis, we got off track. We got off the road. I don't know how it happened, but there we were. We ended up downtown Indianapolis during rush hour. And to make it worse, there was construction on the road. We did not want to be there. That's not where we wanted to be. But that's where we were. And eventually, we got back on track. It wasn't easy, but we got back on track. Sometimes in life, we just make a wrong turn somewhere, and we get on a pathway that leads us in the wrong direction, and it's difficult to get back sometimes. We don't know how, but we've just got to stick with it and eventually get there. This may be our case spiritually. I'm not over here. I'm over here, and I don't know how I got there, but I want to get back over there, and something is keeping me from it. Well, let me ask you a question. What are you looking at? That may seem like a silly question, but what are you looking at? Several years ago, many years ago, Linda and I went skiing, took our kids. We haven't gone skiing much, but we were learning how to ski in the lowest level of skiing ability. And the instructor took us on this bunny slope, this area that had a very slow slope, so you could just go very slowly, but without any effort, you could be moving. And I remember he was showing us how to plow, how to stop, and how to turn. I was going this direction, and he was over here skiing backwards, giving me instruction. He said, "Okay, now, Bob, look at me." And so I looked at him, and lo and behold, my skis just automatically turned and went that direction. But I later understood what had happened. Just a slight turning of my body put enough pressure on the outside ski that it made me turn. I realized from then on, you know, that we are going to go in the direction that we look. Not many of us walk like this. We're going to walk at whatever direction we're looking. So what are you looking at? Whatever it is you've got, you're focusing on, that's the direction that you're going to be going. Paul says in Hebrews, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. The word fix means to look intentionally. I'm not just glancing around looking at things. I have a purpose for looking at that, and I'm going to keep looking at that because that's what I want to accomplish. That's where I want to go. Paul says in 2 Corinthians, for we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For the thing which is seen, or what is seen, is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. So he says you got to look at what you can't see. That doesn't make a lot of sense. But it's important that we realize the spiritual part of us doesn't focus on the seen things. It's got to look at the spiritual things, those things that the Spirit blesses us with. Second thing that I came to realize is that just like it takes something sharp to get into these plastic packages, if I'm going to break through that barrier, I've got to have something sharp that's going to penetrate it. Hebrews 4 and 12 gives us our text for this morning. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joint and marrow, and it judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. Now, there's a whole bunch of stuff that's said there. There's some heavy thoughts in that text. What it is really saying is that the Word of God is where the rubber meets the road. It gets down to the nitty-gritty. Or as my dad would say, it tells you who Sal ate the cabbage. Ever heard that? Yeah. If we look at this in detail, Paul is telling us God's word is alive and it is living, it is active, or it is effective, as some version says. It is something more than just a piece of paper or pages in a book. And it's sharper than any double-edged sword. A sword is sharp, but if you take two edges and put on it, it is sharper. The Word of God is even sharper than anything that they could think about in their time. And it will penetrate. It can cut through the nonsense and get to what really matters. And it divides the soul and the spirit. The word soul here means the body. The word is the same word used when we read about the eight souls that were saved on the ark, the eight persons, the eight people. Do me a favor, reach inside your body and pull out your spirit and show it to me. I can't do that. I don't know how to do that. No, we don't, because we come in one package. Our body and our spirit is together. And because of that, we sometimes even forget that the spirit exists. And it's difficult for us to separate our spirit from our body and look at it the way we need to. The Word of God can do that. It can take the soul and put it over here, the body. It can take our spirit and put it over here. And then we get to the other part where it will judge our thoughts and our attitudes. And we got attitudes. If Elliot were speaking, he'd say, look to the person next to you and say, you got attitudes. But it's scary to think about our attitudes being revealed. He says in the next verse, everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account. And yet that's what we need. If we are going to know what's troubling us and what is preventing us from walking as closely with God as we want to, we've got to have some answers. And the Word of God can give us those answers if we're brave enough to get into it and let it do what it can do for us, to expose everything about us, showing us what's wrong and what needs to be corrected. That's a little scary, but it needs to be done. And you're going to say, well, when we let the Word poke us in the heart, is that going to hurt? You bet it's going to hurt. Whenever Peter talked to those people on the day of Pentecost, and he told them what they had done wrong and how they had crucified the Son of God, the Bible says that when the people heard this, they were cut to the heart. And they said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? They knew they had done wrong because the Word of God had been delivered to them and pointed out the very fact that they had done this atrocious thing. Sure, it hurt. And you remember when the Lord told Peter, who was so blazoned to say he would never forsake Christ, Christ told him, you're going to deny me three times before the cock crows in the morning. And he didn't believe that. But when it happened, Peter remembered the words that Jesus had spoken. He remembered the truth that Jesus had spoken. And he went out and he wept bitterly. It hurts. Sure, it hurts. It's supposed to hurt. That's why God gives us consciences. If we are poked with the truth and it doesn't hurt, then it's too late. And our consciences are seared as with a hot iron. And there's probably no hope for us. So how does this work? Well, let's just apply some of the simple ways that this works. Ask some questions that might lay open our thoughts and our intents and the inner part of our being. So let's start with this question. Why am I here this morning? Well, it's Sunday, isn't it? That's where I am on Sunday morning. Okay. I'm glad you're here. That's a good thing. You can't be in a better place. But why are you here this morning? Well, doesn't the Bible tell us that we're supposed to assemble together and not forsake the assembling of our brethren? Yes. So that's why we're here. Are we saying we're here because we're supposed to be? Let's say it's Friday. You're at work. You're talking with your buddy, and your buddy says, hey, the weekend is here. What are you doing tonight? And you say, well, I don't know. Today's our anniversary, and I'm just not sure what's going to happen tonight. Well, have you gotten your wife flowers yet? No. Well, you're supposed to get your wife flowers. That's what husbands do. And so you stop on the way home to the flower shop. You get this beautiful bouquet of flowers. You come home and you walk in the door and your wife turns around and she almost faints when she sees those flowers in your hand. She is deeply touched. You walk over to her and say, "Happy anniversary," and you give her the flowers. She looks at you with those sweet eyes, and she says, "Oh, honey, that is so thoughtful of you. You didn't have to do this." And you say, "Well, that's what husbands are supposed to do." You just took out all of the joy. You did it because you're supposed to. No telling what she's going to do with those flowers. "God, I'm here because I'm supposed to be." Oh boy, aren't you great. When you went to bed last night, did you think, "Tomorrow I get to go praise and worship God"? When you got up this morning, did you say, "It's today I get to meet with the saints and sing with them and praise the Lord and show Him I love Him"? When you walked in the door, was that your thoughts? When you sat down, was that your thoughts? When did that thought enter your mind? Or has it yet? Are we here because we gotta be, or because we get to be? And it offers us an opportunity to truly worship and praise our Creator. You see, the Word of God says, "I want to test your attitude. Not just your action, I want to know why you're doing what you're doing." In the Old Testament, there was a prophecy made by Isaiah. And it says, "And the Lord said, because this people draw near with their mouth and honor me with their lips, while their hearts are far from me, and their fear of me is a commandment of men learned by rote." What's that saying? Those people here are following a list of rules. By rote, they learn, "I should do this, I should do this, I can't do that." It's a list of do's and don'ts. Their hearts are far from me. They may be following that list to some degree, but where's their heart? That's what I want, is their heart. And then Jesus says, "This came to pass." And he accuses the people of this very thing in his day and time in Matthew 15:8-9, when he says, "The people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men." There's a big difference. What's your heart's attitude? Are you thankful that I've followed the rules? Or are you thankful that you're here having the opportunity to tell God what He means to you? Let's ask another question. Why am I singing this morning? That's what we do. When we meet together, that's one of the five acts of worship. We got to get that in. We sing songs together. Why? Because the Bible says we're to speak one another to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. We're supposed to do that. But there's another part to that same verse which says, "Sing and make melody in your heart to the Lord." Have you been doing that? Did you really feel you were making music and melody in your heart when you're singing? "Well, I don't know what that really is. How does that happen?" You know, the closest thing I can think of to help us understand is when you have a birthday party for your wife, for your husband, for your children, and you sing "Happy Birthday" to them, what's going through your mind? What's your heart feeling? Aren't you saying, "This is a special day for my child or my family member, and I want them to know that I'm concerned about them. I want to express to them the feeling I have inside. Happy birthday." That's not so hard to do, is it? That's singing with music in your heart. That's their day, and we can do that. Isn't this the Lord's day? Aren't we motivated to do the same thing, to express to Him We want you to have a good day because we're worshiping you and we're paying tribute to all that you mean to us. Paul says, I will sing with my spirit, but I'll also sing with my mind. That's because Jesus said that God is spirit and his worshipers must worship in spirit and truth. We praise him in spirit. There's got to be some feeling. There's got to be some meaning there, more than just noise. Do I love God more than anything else in the world? That's what the Word is asking us. When's the last time you answered that? Do you ask yourself that question? Do I really love the Lord more than anything else in the world? When we open the scripture, we find it tells us that we need to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all your soul, and with all of your mind. It's trying to get to opening up our spirit, laying it bare for us to look at. Is this really true? There are so many things that keep us from doing that. It's like the young ruler who had lots of money, and he came to Jesus and he was so proud of his life. And he says, what must I do to have eternal life? And Jesus said, well, you keep the commandments. Well, which ones? And Jesus gives him the commandments. And he said, well, I'll do all of that. What else am I lacking? And then Jesus lays bare his spirit. What he needed to hear, what was keeping him, what his barrier was, he loved those possessions more than he did the Lord. He says, if you want to be perfect, then you go. You sell your possessions, you give them to the poor, and you'll have treasure in heaven, and then you come and follow me. Just as those words of truth reveal his barrier, it will reveal ours also if we have enough nerve and enough want to do it. We've got to ask for God's help in this. We can't do it ourselves. We're not smart enough. We're too carnal-minded. The Spirit isn't strong enough for us to do this on our own. We need God's help. And it's like the request that David made when he said, search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. David was saying, God, look at me. Help me to see what faults are in my life. And then show them to me. Once you reveal them, let me see them and let me look at them and then lead me in the right way. You know, in a nutshell, what we need to see God, we need to see ourselves, I should say, as God sees us. When we can see us as God does, when we can look in that mirror and we see the image in its truthfulness, it may be ugly, but we can fix it with God's help. I don't know what your barrier is. I don't have a clue. I'm having a hard enough time figuring out what my barriers are. I'm getting there, but I'm not there yet. But if I keep digging into the truth, it's going to reveal to me, and it will reveal to you, what's the problem. So, if you're here this morning and you've struggled with trying to get over there to where you need to be, where your life is walking step by step with God and the Spirit, dig into the Word. And if we can help you in any way do that, why don't you come as we stand and sing.
Oh God, you are my God, and I